Good evening, everyone. On behalf of the Rohini Nilekani Philanthropies, welcome to the session, Citizenship as a Service. The aim of the session is to deep dive into the role of technology in enabling active citizenship. What is the opportunity it offers and what are its limitations and exclusions? These are some of the themes that we will try to uncover in the session. Before we begin, just a few housekeeping rules for the audience. There are two windows or tabs to your right. The chat window for conversations on topics being discussed. We encourage you to use the chat window as much as you can. And the Q&A window explicitly for questions that you may have. Ask your questions throughout the conversation and note that the questions can be upvoted as well. We hope to run the session for 50 minutes. And for the last 10 minutes, we hope to take the most upvoted questions and direct them towards the speakers. With that, let me hand over to our moderator for this session, Sarayu Natarajan, founder of the APTI Institute, to introduce the speakers and to take the session forward. Over to you, Sarayu.
Thanks very much, Yash, and thanks to everybody for tuning in. I know I always say this, but it's 5 p.m. on a Saturday evening, and there are very many other things you could be doing. So thank you for tuning in, and thank you for your attention. I am Sarayu. I'm the founder of APTI Institute, and we are a public research institution that looks at the intersection of technology and society. And I'm very, very excited to moderate this conversation. I was just saying to Aniket a few minutes ago that we were on a panel similarly last year at the difficult end of the panel. And fortunately, now I get to sit here and listen to what will hopefully be a wonderful conversation. So thank you to the panelists for doing this. My excitement in this topic is both personal and professional. I've always been excited by the idea of citizenship, but also since I'm very interested in politics, I find citizenship to be a very exciting, very dynamic idea that is evolving. And indeed, in a certain way, it's almost the only real thing that you can see. The professional interest, of course, is very deep as well. For us, our interest in governance, in the intersection of governance and technology, makes citizenship very important and very exciting to think about. But also, increasingly, we've realized, particularly with the intersection of technologies, that citizenship is this big horizontal idea and something that's very relevant in making good happen in several domains. So whether it's health, whether it's governance, education, citizenship is a key driver for good things to happen. The intersection of technology is also very, very important to think about here. What it does, like the session itself, is enable, democratize access, so enable people from all over in very many contexts to participate and to engage. But what it can also do is end up exacerbating or re-entrenching divides. And being conscious of that is what we hope to sort of bring out a little bit more in this conversation. What's also exciting, particularly recently, is the growth of a civic technology space, and particularly led by bazaar actors, firms that play a role in developing technologies and implementing them in communities, in finding ways to bridge the gap between the citizen and the state. And this, again, brings with it its own benefits, but also potentially harms. And so this intersection of technology and market and the effects it can produce, the good it can bring, as well as some of the risks, is what we'll try and talk about a little bit over the course of this conversation. But also, you know, so that we go into the next decade, the 2020s, thinking of more resilient, more robust ways and being aware of some of the nuances of it. So, quick introduction of our panelists. The detailed bios are in the chats, but we are joined by Anisha Gopi, who's a team lead at Nyaya. Anisha and I go way back, so if this sounds like a banter session, please forgive us, but Anisha and I went to college at the same time. Viraj is the CEO of eGovernance Foundation. We do quite a bit of work together and hoping to pick up some of the threads of those conversations in the rest of the session today. And then, of course, we're joined by Aniket Diogar, who is the CEO and co-founder founder of Hak Darshak. And Hak Darshak is a company that I watched over the last couple of years with great excitement. I think the work that you do is so critical. It speaks to some of the work that I did in my life prior to Aapti. So I am very excited to hear from you, Aniket, again, and you know, to see what has happened over the past year as well. Welcome to our panelists. Just jumping straight in, one of the things you know that we keep talking about and keep hearing about is some of the benefits of technology, and would love to dig deeper into this question with each of the panelists in turn. But you know, what has technology done for citizenship that was not possible 10, 20 years ago? And love for that thought around technology and the intersection with markets, since like, you know, like that whole new space that seems to be emerging. What is now possible that wasn't possible if, you know, a decade or two ago? And I'd love to hear from the panelists in turn. So Anisha, I'd love to hear from you about how that manifests in the space of justice. And then over to Viraj and then Aniket. Over to you, Anisha.
Great. Thanks, Arjun. And hi, everyone. You're absolutely right. It's been a completely new playing field in most aspects of life, but I'll just focus on technology and access to justice, and maybe I'll try to give some examples of how technology has changed the playing field and the way we've been working. So basically, technology has played a huge role in democratizing access to information, creating awareness about rights and empowering people to enforce them. And this is great because it enables engagement with the system and then, of course, active citizenship. And as Saryu mentioned, or it'll be in our bios at least, so I work with Nyaya, which is an open access digital resource that basically simplifies laws and provides actionable legal information. So now with regard to our work, we have over 500 million smartphone users in India, and which means we have a much, much wider reach than we did much like 10 years ago. So say for 15 years ago, we wanted to do a legal awareness program, and Saryu and I in law school used to do a lot of these. It would take most of our day. We would go to like this village on the outskirts of Bangalore and then spend our whole day there speaking to say 30 women. And then we'd come back and say, wow, that was a lot of impact. We've changed, I've given them so much information. Today, I can sit on my couch, record this video, and then I can get it translated into 9 different regional languages with the help of this great legal translation tool called SOAS. And then this content has the potential to reach, say, hundreds of people in rural India via the IVR radio channel run by fantastic organizations like Gramvani. Thousands of people will watch it on our YouTube and social media channels. Hopefully they'll share it on ShareChat and on WhatsApp. And then if I'm lucky, a young person will take it, summarize it, point to different points in it and make a reel out of it, and it'll go viral. And then by the next morning, I have 1 million viewers. So obviously the number of people who we can reach has increased exponentially. And even though there is, of course, a large segment of the population that has been excluded by the digital divide, it's still a lot more than the English-speaking audience that we used to have, which makes just 10% of the population who could initially access this legal information. There are also, of course, a lot of issues with wrong and false information and the need to create centers of authoritative information. And I'm sure that this is something we'll discuss as we go forward in this conversation. Developments in technology have also made mobilization possible like never before. So both in person and online. And just not just in the form of resistance, like in the farmers' protests, but also coming together to help during the pandemic. And again, if I'd use an example from our work, on a Thursday, when the second wave hit India and it was moving from the cities to more rural areas, we said, okay, we need to do more. So we said, let's launch a WhatsApp helpline where people could send us voice notes with their legal problems and we'll try to help. By Monday, the helpline was launched and we had over 200 lawyers and law students who were volunteering their time from 21 states. I mean, this ability to be reactive and dynamic and fill gaps is such a huge benefit. 20 years ago, by the time we mobilized the resources, the need would have changed. So, I mean, this is a great, great, great way that things have changed, and technology plays a huge role in this. It's also made collaboration much easier. The world is a smaller place. We can work across continents and learn from others real time instead of reinventing the wheel. So we don't have to make the same mistakes. Like today, I can see that Hak Darshak has done all of these things and not look through some annual report somewhere in some library and say, okay, I don't need to make these mistakes. I can learn from them and move forward. And that's amazing. It's also helped a lot with legal research and policy decisions. Also, the new live real-time reporting of judicial proceedings that organizations like Live Law and Bar and Bench have been doing has created a lot more engagement with the legal system, and it's made it more accessible and transparent. So this is something that, again, the law was this thing that was only meant for the legal fraternity. Engaging with it was so complicated and difficult. It's now just become more accessible. And the digitizing of court documents and translating them has transferred a lot of the power from lawyers to the litigants, who now have more agency. Another barrier, I think, to justice is delay. I think an average case in India could take almost 4 years to be resolved. So tech solutions can help with that a lot by taking the burden off the courts. Like, there are online dispute resolution forums. There are a lot of things that can be done. It can't, of course, replace the judges who actually need to sit and provide their inputs, but it can smooth the process along further. Also, with the pandemic, I think we've moved by leaps and bounds and much faster than we planned to, because now we have e-filings, e-hearings, e-trials, and the Supreme Court has now presented their vision for e-courts. And if this is done properly, it could make justice delivery affordable, accessible, transparent, and accountable. However, the problem is these sort of interventions need to take into consideration those who can't access the technology and back it with like the adequate social and human architecture that's required to bridge that technical divide. And if they don't do that, obviously the chances of success are very low. And I think this is something I'm sure Aniket and Viraj will talk about a lot. So maybe I'll stop here and let them discuss this, since they've been working on this for so long.
Yeah, thank you so much, Anisha. That, you know, is it resembles the way in which technology intercedes with citizenship in very many domains, but justice also has its own sort of unique characteristics, and hopefully pick up some of the threads of that conversation over the course of today. I'm going to sort of, you know, kick this question over to Viraj. And given the work that eGov does with governments across the country at the state level, and some of the work at the central level as well, would love to understand from your perspective, what digital technologies do, what are some of the things we are able to think of now in the context of governance and accountability that we couldn't have, you know, even 5 years ago, I would imagine. But over to you, Viraj.
Thanks, Aryu. And thanks, Anisha, for setting it up nicely. Just very quickly, eGov Foundation, we essentially enable delivery of public services in an accessible, transparent, and easy to do manner for citizens of India. So we work with around 14 states. And the idea is to really create a platform, open platform, on which market can play. I think we'll talk about it a bit later. So anywhere from applying for a new water connection to paying your taxes to raising a complaint to, you know, applying for a new house permit and all those kind of things you can do using this technology. So a couple of things. I think one is, as Anisha said, around access. I think, and I'll talk about a different aspect of access. When you look at urban India, we always think of Delhi, Mumbai, Chennai, and all those things. You know, with the scale that technology gives you, right, you can actually do things across states in a matter of days. So, give you an example. We launched a WhatsApp bot to pay your municipal taxes in Punjab, in all the ULBs. And guess what? The highest uptake of this is in a Nagar Panchayat called Kurali with 25,000 people, right? I think 5 years ago you couldn't have thought of about doing something like that in a small town India, right? Whereas Amritsar is at, you know, despite having 18 lakh people, is at, you know, 5% adoption. So I think democratizing access, not just in terms of what kind of people it can go to, but what kind of geographies it can go to. So that's one. Second is around scale. You know, you can truly do things, not to do some what we call islands of excellence, but you can do it across states. So I think, you know, in one go, in 167 urban local bodies in Punjab, you can have a reform around how to handle public grievances, right? So that is, again, the new kind of technology paradigm you have around open platforms, you know, population scale platforms, make it real. And that really is, in a way, how quickly do the benefits reach at a population scale? You know, you can have a great system running in BBMP, you know, Bangalore one, but can, you know, a small town like, you know, Longowal in Punjab run that or not? So that's the second thing. And third thing is speed. You know, you can do things very quickly, you know. I'll give an example, again, a pandemic example, when the pandemic struck and the lockdown happened. There was a real issue around how do you move essential workers in a manner which is safe for the communities and for them. And similarly, we got a call on a Saturday. By Monday, you know, by repurposing what we had built, we kind of built an e-pass system. And within 2 weeks, you know, that e-pass system was live in 10 states and more than 10 lakh journeys were enabled. So that's against, you could have never thought of those things 5 years ago, because everything was very, very, you know, point, it was pointed, you know, in a particular context. And finally, I think I would say observability. You know, what digital platforms do, whether it's in a physical channel, doesn't matter whether you go to the ULB counter or you have a mobile app or you have WhatsApp, the same facts will remain that you have a property which has 480 square yards of area, the tax is this much, if you pay by this date, you will get this. And so I think, and you can see what has happened at each stage. So if you have to go back and say, okay, who approved this particular map, you can actually go back and see at what point in time that event is recorded. So that is, again, very powerful, both in terms of creating transparency in the system, but also for the government to kind of create data which is reliable to make decisions which are based on data, not just in terms of anecdotes. And final thing I'll say is the capacity of the government. You know, I think we forget that the world has moved to 21st century, but a lot of parts of government are still in, you know, a paper-based methodology. So I think giving that capacity, and we talk about government capacity is a lot, but we've realized that, you know, we did a survey in Andhra Pradesh when we spoke to the municipal employees, and we thought they'll not like the platform. But they said they love it because they save 19 hours a day, 19 hours a week on their work because they've got tools to do their jobs better. So I think all those things have become possible because you can do things at scale and speed. Over.
Oops. Thank you so much, Viraj, and you know, completely resonate and all that you said. I'm going to now move to hear from Aniket, because some of the work that you do is truly unique. It's at the intersection of the citizen and the state, and being able to sort of bridge that gap. And would love to hear from you in terms of how that's transformed access to the state more broadly, particularly for underserved communities. Over to you, Aniket.
Thanks, Ayu. So I think when we started, working on government schemes, access, and Nagdarshak, we used technology and field entrepreneurs, women entrepreneurs, in terms of delivery of schemes in two majorly rural areas and underserved populations. And we built a sophisticated rules engine to begin with, and then we quickly realized that that's not really working because information was a big gap. But then another gap in all the technology that that is there, it's to whom are we building, for whom are we building it for? That's really, really important. And I think when we look at the end user, there is always a person required to handhold and help. And that's the nature of the kind of people we are solving these problems for. And I think that's where it's very important that technology is to be looked at in a very subjective way. For us, a complicated algorithm, an engine which is mapping to different products and platforms can be technology. For someone in rural India, a simple SMS is also technology. A simple WhatsApp message is also technology. An IVR phone and some IVR message is a technology. So I think how we are using technology for delivering welfare in different means for whom is really, really important. And that's where we have seen our work kind of evolve. Rather than building and looking at the platform as the product, we are looking as our Hakdarshaks as the product. We are building the product for them, for our women entrepreneurs to then take it to the community. If it works for them, then the scheme delivery will happen, because the people are taking up the schemes basis them, not necessarily because of the schemes itself. It's the information delivery that is happening. Yes, it comes out as an eligibility criteria, but it's that women entrepreneur who's from that community, from that village, who's able to tell them, yes, you need to take up that scholarship, that pension. If you apply for this certificate, you'll get this benefit. So I think more and more, I think in this space, I believe that we need to look at, really step back and think, for whom are we building it? And different technologies and different platforms have uses for different kind of users. But in our case, I think that connect to the last mile, we have really seen that in the kind of users we want to impact, we really want to have that filter of that service delivery agent. And that's where we have really worked on a lot of aspects in terms of not only simplifying it, but also listening from the ground on what is working, what is not working. Obviously, I think completely agree with Anisha and Viraj in terms of how it is. I mean, technology is the only way to scale in a country as large and as diverse as ours. It also leads to a lot of democratization of information, giving an equal level playing field. But I still feel that we need to think of technology as not as a one-fits-all solution, which ends up happening. How can we kind of make it a much more decentralized process, but also a very diverse bit in using for different use cases. I mean, a simple example, right? Like we were pushing schemes for MSMEs since last year, and since you were asking me what had changed, this is one of the new things that we started doing. And for small businesses, we were doing a simple government application of an Aadhaar card, right? And when we started working with some transgender communities, where we wanted to see how they can become entrepreneurs, they don't even have an Aadhaar. So whatever technology solution you can build, and you can build a massive UIDAI system, until we also work on the level of policy advocacy, the middle layer, in at least understanding and addressing some of those issues, then it becomes, I think, a little difficult. So I think that in terms of the same technology being used for the in a one fit all solution is also, I think, on the ground sometimes doesn't work.
That's a fascinating point. I mean, the idea that while technology is truly the only way to reach the most distant communities, the most sort of faraway individual or faraway citizens, it also within itself carries a few limitations. I'd love to sort of dig a little bit deeper on that point, particularly from the work that you do, Aniket. One is, you know, you mentioned the need for, you know, some communities don't have the ability to participate in the digital world, and this could be for a range of reasons. Are there other ways in which the limitations of technology could in themselves be playing out? Could it be excluding? And in some ways, does it also re-entrench some of the divides that already exist in society? So would love to hear your thoughts based on your experience on this question, on the limitations of tech.
No, so absolutely. I think, I'll give you some examples of our work. So we work, like I mentioned, with women entrepreneurs. And if you would think of it, we built a very strong capacity building training program. We also, for our first batch in Chhattisgarh, figured out smartphones for them, because smartphones was a challenge. But then we saw a massive drop, right? These are entrepreneurs who go back to the community and help citizens get access to schemes. Now, the challenge there was that we didn't count for the patriarchal issues in the communities. Because even when we got them the smartphones, they were not the first ones to get it in their house, because they were last on priority and they would get the feature phone. So I think it's absolutely right that today we have a telecom industry and an internet industry which spreads across the country. You would not find any district or village probably which does not have access to basic internet, 2G, 4G, or I mean, at least 2G. But the fact is that in that household, in that particular village, there is a dynamic of gender, there's a dynamic of caste, there is a dynamic of religion, which is also playing out. So I think that's where I feel that access in terms of technology is not even. And in our country, because of the scale, that pure absolute number is massive, right? I mean, it is not a small percentage. It just becomes such a big number that for some of these, and that's why we need to pick community champions and community agents for whom more and more technology has to be built in a very localized manner, and then using local language, using different tools and giving them different options can be some of the things. But yeah, largely I've seen that some of these aspects in terms of, especially in the rural aspect, I think that those are things that really play out and become a big barrier.
Absolutely. I think this is also something we keep hearing in our research, that the divides on technology sort of tend to play out along the lines of existing social divides and gender, as you mentioned, community, caste, geographic location also play out in significant ways. I'd love to sort of, you know, take this question to Anisha. I know you hinted at it as well, Anisha, in the context of the justice system. But how might some of these barriers play out in terms of limiting the impact that technology could have? And I'd love to hear about it specifically from the lens of the information work that you do, but also more broadly in the context of the justice system.
I was on mute. So firstly, the biggest problem, just as Aniket said, is access, right? So it's cost, connectivity, language, literacy. I mean, all of these are obvious barriers. And I feel like one of the main barriers also is that a lot of the tech is created by the bazaar. And there are, of course, exceptions, but it's created for profit. And some sections or some parts of our population are not considered as profitable. So the technology is created to cater to a certain group of people in terms of literacy, language, everything. And even the marketing strategy is catered to them in ways that is not easily understandable or not accepted by a very large majority of the population. And since the profit comes from the smaller part, there's no care that's been taken to include them in creating this technology. And what's sad is that there is a huge benefit because it's scale. It's like there's so many people who will be involved and they are able to pay at some level for these services. It's not that they aren't profitable. It's just not a high margin of profit. So one, the bazaar creates it. So a lot of innovation is created for different groups of societies, excluding a large group. And also when civil society organizations want to create this, they don't have those sort of funds accessible to them because no one wants to take a risk investing on something that has already such a low profit margin and then could fail. So innovation really reduces at this in this sector. And that's the problem, that you're not willing to take those risks to innovate because you're worried that where will you get the funds for? Another barrier is the sense of distrust. So people will be happy to download a WhatsApp or maybe a TakaTuk, but won't download Kovin because they don't understand the value that it has for them. And no one has taken that trouble to make sure that they understand the value that it is. It's just assumed this is good for you, so you'll download it. But that's not how it works. And so basically all our solutions need to be more technology enabled and not technology led in terms of use existing resources people are comfortable with, use social human architecture, get people involved, get community-based organizations involved with people they trust. I think Aniket was talking about this also in another session about the messenger is really important as the message. And that's exactly where we're coming from too, that if you get people who you can trust to tell me that this is a good app, this is useful for me, I'll trust it. If I have someone who I know whose job is to make me use it, I won't trust it. So that's usually really helpful. In terms of accessing justice delivery mechanisms, there are a whole bunch of barriers, again, like awareness, literacy, language. And language is a huge problem because most higher court judgments are in English. And that's 10% of the population. So basically all the power is in the hands of the lawyers. And the litigant has no idea actually what's happening. And they just go along in this whirlwind of things and they never know actually whether they've been exploited, are they getting their rights? And it doesn't even, like the system is so overwhelming that a lot of times people just choose not to engage and to be exploited than actually try to enforce their rights. And that's very problematic because this can be fixed. But, assume there's a person who has all of the privileges, all the entitlements and gets through all of these barriers of language complexity, time, everything gets to court. Sometimes you still don't get justice this 4 years later, and that's a minimum really usually. So say 10 years later, you've gone to court, you've got this judgment and you still haven't got justice. And these are systemic problems like corruption, power dynamics and things like that. And this is unfortunately something technology can't fix. So we need to work on building capacity, awareness, trust, and especially our last mile communities need to understand that there is support and they should be able to access it. And it's not, everyone just needs to work together to reach that, to navigate these mechanisms.
Thank you for that, Anisha. In fact, this is some of the research that we did with eGov as well, which said a lot of the things that both Aniket and you mentioned, the importance of human intermediation, that there's a certain level of trust that community leadership in various forms already has with individuals. So thinking about sort of making them a part of the process or rather enabling them to do their work better is something that needs a lot more thinking and a lot more work. But there's another aspect of technology that we don't often discuss a lot and that I'd love to hear from you, Viraj, on that, which is from the technology design capacity, capability side itself. Is there something that we need to think about in the context of the limitations? What we heard from Anisha and Aniket related to some of the breakdowns at the societal level and the way in which all of these structures intersect with tech, but would love to hear from you on the tech side as well. Unmute, please.
Yeah. No, I think fascinating conversation. I think one of the things about, I always say, one of the biggest limitations is how technologists think, because they're always trying to solve a problem, right? Whereas I think what Anisha and Aniket are kind of saying is, actually you need to give people tools and methods to solve problems, because the complexity and diversion of problem is huge. You know, what is faced in, you know, in Chirala, which is a small town of 30,000 people, Andhra Pradesh, versus what is true for Amritsar are very different realities, language, context, culture. So I think this whole concept of what we call distribute the ability to solve, don't solve. Because when you solve, you're basically value capturing. And that's the issue, you know, and that's how markets operate. There's nothing, you know, they have incentives to, you know, capture value, right? So I think the design has to be so that actually it increases the capabilities of actor across Samaj Sarkar and Bazaar, right? That's where you can truly have the impact. That if I'm a last mile, you know, community leader, how can I use this technology easily? Don't make it complex for me. Don't ask me to go through hoops. Meet me where I am, right? Through WhatsApp, I can, you know, mobilize my community, or somebody in community has a problem, I can reach the government in a reliable manner. So I think those are the, you know, how do you make those interactions friction-free? How do you make those interactions trustworthy? And how do you not control the value by building solutions? So I think that's where, you know, what we call digital public goods come into play, you know, where you actually build platforms for social without any profit motive, because fact is that markets will not create it because they don't have the incentive to do it, right? Fact is that governments may not create it because they may not have the capability. But using the, why shouldn't the technology that people are used to using on Paytm or on Flipkart not be available to a, you know, first mile community worker? It should be, right? So that's where what we call designing interoperable, open, public digital goods is extremely important, because that can set in motion things that you haven't thought about today, right? For example, when I gave you the e-pass example, we never thought 4 years ago when we started designing Digit, which is our kind of public digital good for service delivery, that this could be used for e-pass. But the ecosystem came together from Unilever to P&G to kind of Fiki to the ministry and saying, let's design it together, right? And that's when the magic happens, when the cost of coordination goes down. Second thing is, you know, you need to make sure you absorb complexity. Don't make it complex. I think both of you alluded to that. You know, I think sitting in Bangalore, we've got a San Francisco design ethos, right? Whereas somebody who's on ground, you know, they need to really, you have to make it simple. So one of the roles of technology has to absorb complexity and make it easy. That this is not hard. You just have to go on WhatsApp and call this, do this missed call, and you'll be able to access the service. So I think I really feel, especially in the context of service delivery, to citizens in an equitable and access manner, you know, making communities stronger so that it is not taking agency away from them. Technology should not say, you know, because the trust that people have in the local system is unbeatable, you know. So actually empower, kind of enabling them to use technology to do their jobs better. That's where I really believe digital public goods have a big role to play. I mean, I don't know how many of you know, when you look at something like India Stack or Aadhaar, you know, and people have different views, but impact hit on financial inclusion. If you looked at the, you know, the banking curve India had in terms of what is the penetration of banking, you know, there's a famous study from BIS, Bank of International Settlements, which said it would have taken 47 years for India to get to the penetration that it reached in 4 years. So that's what it makes possible. So I think I can't underline enough that, you know, let's not expect market to do what it is not incentivized to do. You know, let's think about building public digital goods that markets can also use to, you know, deliver service to the communities, and the governments can use it similarly.
Right. Thanks, Viraj. That drops off at a very interesting juncture. So I'm going to sort of pass it on to hear from Aniket, because one of the things that we hear very often in the context of digital infrastructures more broadly is the idea that civil society can fill a gap. This is interesting, but also carries with it certain connotations of what one can expect civil society organizations to do. And I'd love to hear from Aniket, you know, reflections on this. You know, what could the role of civil society in the context of technology, access, citizenship be? And how might that play out? Over to you, Aniket. Do I wonder if you've frozen for a second? I think we might have lost Aniket, and his signal shows red. Is that you? Right, I'll pass the question over to Anisha, and then maybe once Aniket is back, we could sort of hear from him on this. But Anisha, you know, on this role of civil society, I know we've had a broader discussion on this question. What is the role civil society can play in the context of filling the gap between citizen and the state, and how might how might we think about some of the boundaries around this engagement?
Sure. So I think civil society can play a huge role by taking some of the state burden off the state and helping in, say, Aniket's back. Aniket, you want to take over or shall I continue? Okay, I'll continue. Take the burden off the state. Civil society can also demand more accountability and fight for diverse groups, like especially marginalized groups. And I think that's something that's unique to civil society, which I think the market can't do as well, because it becomes problematic when resisting abuse of power, resisting government action. So I think that's something that civil society can do really well and should do very well to act as, to provide some form of check and balance to the state and to even the market, really. Also, I think, like Viraj said and Aniket said, that civil society has better knowledge and understanding to be able to translate instructions and keep in mind ground reality. So that's a useful tool that should be harnessed, really, and used much more to get civil society actors involved in the process from conceptualization itself, and then help roll it out too. Also, they can increase the communication of information between different parts of civil society and ensure more engagement. But there are obviously guardrails and boundaries in terms of rule of law, right? Like everyone has to be confined within the confines of rule of law, and they have to ensure that they're not encroaching on any person's rights or misusing resources. Another boundary, I think, comes, and this is, I think we saw this during the pandemic, is civil society can help with certain functions, but they can't take over state functions and shouldn't be expected to. It's not possible for civil society to take over state functions. That's the state's role. And even though they can assist from the margins, you can't shift the burden onto civil society and say, okay, go ahead, do it. Because I can't provide ration. I mean, it's just not something that civil society is capable or equipped to do. So that needs to be kept in mind while saying, okay, these are the boundaries within this framework, do as much as you can. And for the rest of the stuff, I think state bodies, the market, everyone needs to be held accountable for not really doing their part. I think you're on mute, Saryu.
Sorry, you're on mute.
Hi, am I audible now? It's 2021. I still haven't figured out how to toggle the mute and unmute button. But you know, that's a very interesting point that you make, Anisha. You know, while civil society can play a role in sort of advocating the cause of certain communities, they cannot be expected to fill in the gap that the state leaves. But you know, I'd have to sort of take that to the broader, and you know, some of the things that you also said earlier on the limitations of some of the market mechanisms, where there are no profit pools, the market does not go. And I'd love to hear from Viraj on some of the reflections around the eGov. I hesitate to say business model, but the eGov model, and digging in a little bit deeper into the question of public goods as well. What were the choices that drove this approach from the back end, and how do you think about framing the question of citizenship and agency in that sense, in the way that you do your work?
Yeah. No, I think two or three things. One is we were very invested in, you know, making sure the impact is at scale and speed, because, you know, when you look at delivery of public services in India, there's a lot to be done. So I think that was the main reason why we are an 18-year-old organization. For a good part of our lives, we were a solution builder. We worked with governments and built solutions in urban governance. So 5-6 years ago, we kind of started thinking, and we were like at 100 ULBs at that point in time, in terms of that this is really going to take a long time. So main thing was that we thought about what would make it go at scale and speed. And that's why this whole concept of, you know, how do you involve Samaj, Sarkar and Bazaar in solving this, rather than trying to make it your own, you know, mission to solve. What Anisha was saying, it's not, you know, government job is to deliver services, right? But you can kind of increase their capability so that they can build it better from a digital point of view. So I think that was the main reason why we thought about, you know, taking an approach where we said we'll build a digital public good, we'll invest behind it and build it so that it's truly open, it's truly interoperable. People can build on top of it various solutions. But I think what was critical was the shift we made to becoming not, I mean, tech is not the answer. I think what you can do with the tech is the answer. And one of the roles we took on was to actually say, how do we create imagination? You know, how do you enable people? Okay. And that is advocacy, you know, whatever word you want to use for that. But that is really making it real for people, not saying, hey, we've built this platform, come and play. It doesn't work like that, right? So I think we spend a lot of time, you know, working with governments and evangelizing why this is a good way to solve your problems, why this is a good way to run programs for public service delivery. Similarly, we spend a lot of time with the, you know, private players. We have 20 plus partners, right? We're saying why, when the next RFP comes for this kind of a thing, you should use our platform and we'll be there to support you and enable you. So today, almost 40% of eGov is in this orchestration and enablement kind of an area, because just building technology is not good enough. You have to make it real and you have to show the benefits to people, say, this is worth taking risk, right? Because it's very easy to go to SAP and IBM because those are safe bets, right? But if you're making a new bet in using a public digital good, you have to really invest behind that and say, this is how it works. So I think a lot of, I would say, in last 3 years, you know, that's the realization we had, that we need to become a enabling organization rather than building a tech builder. You know, of course, we'll build tech. And that has been a real shift in terms of, you know, and that's when we really started scaling up. Today, almost 9 partners are working with, you know, 10 states, you know, taking this platform and building stuff. There, you know, 20 different solutions being built. So it's truly becoming owned by the ecosystem. I mean, we still have a lot of work to do with the community actors. I think we did our first program. Tomorrow is being launched with the Reap Benefit. Their Solve Ninjas are going to use, their community players, Solve Ninjas will use our chatbot to, you know, connect with the municipalities. But I think on the orchestration of the citizens and government working in a trustworthy fashion, programs being driven by, you know, the same money, the public money being used more judiciously, you know, in programmatic sense, with the collaboration of Samaj and Sarkar and Bazaar, I think we made some good progress.
Right. I think Aniket's back, but while we wait for him to settle in, I'd like to sort of dig a little deeper into one question that's been sort of, you know, there are some early strands of discussion around it. Anisha, would love to hear from you around this question of the justice system more broadly in and of itself. Is there something that's exceptional about this space? Just given that, you know, very many aspects of justice delivery are so closely linked to state function. And, you know, is there a nuanced approach that one needs to think about here, and would love to hear your thoughts on that. Aniket, we'll just hear from Anisha and then come back to you, because there was a couple of threads I think we'd love to pick up.
Okay. I'll be very quick. I mean, this is a very complicated and very nuanced question. And I think that the whole point of the justice system is that no one should be left behind, right? And the judiciary enforces the rule of law to keep the Sarkar, Samaj, and Bazaar in check. So they're expected, I mean, the judiciary is expected to be the guarantor of constitutional norms. So, and none of the Sarkar, Samaj, or Bazaar will not be able to thrive in the absence of rule of law and stability. So to do this, the judiciary requires to be independent. It needs to be separate from all of these three. And that puts it in a unique position, because then who holds the judiciary accountable? And I mean, that's led to a whole bunch of problems in terms of the political role of courts, and whether in judgments and like how they choose judgments, and whether they choose certain cases to hear, and the cases that come up, the cases that they delay, is there a political intent behind it? And sometimes there is, and it's very hard to prove that or hold the judiciary accountable for that without having a contempt case issued against you, because it's very difficult to prove. It's subjective, and there's no, I mean, you can ask the court to be accountable if they've set aside evidence or don't follow procedural norms. But what do you do in cases where it's it's a subjective decision that the court makes. How do you hold them accountable? How do you, and this is especially true in terms of, say, Article 142 where the of the Constitution, where the Supreme Court has plenary powers and can pass orders in the interest of complete justice as it feels. So it can just choose topics that it thinks it needs to intervene in and then pass judgments based on that. And I mean, that's at the court's discretion, but that creates a form of judicial exceptionalism, which is, I mean, it has something to be discussed about. I mean, I can't say that, I mean, some cases it could be good, in some cases it could be political, and that creates some problems. I mean, they also, yeah, I think that's what I have to say on that.
Right, no, that's fascinating. And I think, would love to hear, Aniket, I think what we'd love to pick up with you is this question around some of the ethical choices behind the business model that you have chosen, or rather the approach that you have chosen, how some of that links back to how you think of the limitations or the opportunities that technology affords, which you've spoken about a little bit, but specifically also some of the sense around what the market can do. Aniket, if you're here, I'm just going to give it a moment in the hope that we can hear from Aniket.
You're on mute, Aniket, in case you're speaking.
I wonder if that's the interface has been a bit glitchy, showing, of course, the limitations of technology, despite the possibilities of democratizing access. But I, you know, maybe this is also for us to sort of bring this session together and think of some of the opportunities, which is what we started it. So bringing the session to a full circle. Would love to hear from both of you, Viraj as well as Anisha, what you look forward to with most excitement over the next few months for sure, but over the next decade, particularly from the framing of resilience. How do you think about resilient societies, and how can technology be that enabler of it?
I'll go first. Okay. No, I think the I guess the biggest thing that I am looking forward to is really how do you ensure that people who work in communities are enabled and they can do much better job of what they're doing, because they're already doing a fantastic job. I almost see there's a bit of a divide. You know, tech is almost seen as a centralist thing, which I think it might be true. And that's one of the, I think I would say, one of the fears I have, that you can actually, if you centralize it too much, you can actually do harm. But really, how do you get participation from community actors to see, and how do you make, you know, the tech so accessible and so easy to use that somebody who's working in a small village in Bihar should be able to say, okay, I need to do a survey, this is how I do it. Or I need to kind of find out, you know, what are the data about the location I'm in, or there's a concern one of my community actors has, community member has, that they want to raise it to the state. How do we do that? And so I think that is my that'll be really cool if in 4 or 5 years we have, you know, millions of community actors who are actually using, you know, digital tools to do their jobs better, not to replace what they're doing, because that's irreplaceable. And that's where the balance between Samaj, Sarkar, and Bazaar need to come through, because I think a lot of times Samaj is the last to adopt these things for various reasons. And I think there are systemic barriers that we need to think about. There are simplification tasks that technology has, and the whole evangelization and advocacy. So I think that's what, you know, keeps me excited about what I'm doing.
Thank you so much, Viraj. So excited to see the next 10 years of eGov. Anisha, would love to hear from you. What is exciting? Technology in justice is very much nascent, very early stages, and it's sort of popping up in various aspects of legal practice as we know it. And would love to hear what you think is most exciting about this space.
On the queue.
Did we lose Anisha as well?
Sorry, I'm back.
I think it's just you and me, Viraj. But if I may speak for Anisha momentarily, I think
there is a button which is kind of making people disappear.
Viraj, you're the tech man, not me. I'm all about citizenship, so I'd be giving more buttons for people to participate.
No, sir, I'm back. I'm sorry.
Anisha, I would love to hear from you on what's exciting to you.
So the thing is, in terms of access to justice, I mean, I would love to see us being able to simplify it, right? Like in terms of like, there's so many laws, there's so many state notifications, there's so many judgments, like this whole area of knowledge is just very complicated and very complex. And it was in the legal fraternity's interests to keep it that way. Because then you have like that, it's like, you know, how all the prayers are in Sanskrit and then they didn't want to like make it more, it's similar in terms of, it's in the legal fraternity's interest for it to be complicated, but actually it's not. Right? I mean, and if we actually want people to be able to access it, we need to find ways to simplify it. And this is a problem we have in terms of just a regular translation. I can't ask a regular translator to translate my legal document because there's so many nuances. One word wrongly translated completely changes the meaning of the sentence. So that's an additional level of complexity legal information has. And there's this whole, there are all movements on like simplifying laws and making it like natural language laws and everything. And I mean, that's great and really helpful. But I think what we need is for the whole legal community to come together and help simplify the process. Law students, lawyers, everyone spend some time creating that awareness and that understanding so that it trickles down. Because right now it's all very in the high court level and it's complicated and difficult. And the technology definitely helps with this. And it creates transparency, it creates accountability, it creates faster processes. And as Viraj said, it helps you scale in such a great way. But I think it requires a lot of resources to help. So how Aniket said that they needed Haktashaks, we had the same problem. So we had this WhatsApp helpline, but still it was one level too complicated for someone at the very grassroots level who wasn't like tech savvy or wasn't able to type and things like that. So we needed caseworkers so we worked with Gramvani, and Gramvani had caseworkers who would collate the information through their IVR channel and then send them to us. And this requires a lot of resources. So it requires human power to help do that. Or a repeated thing that we got from a lot of the organizations that we worked with was, okay, great, this is my legal information, but what next? How do I approach the court? How do I navigate the system? And that again requires resources. It requires a person to help you navigate the system. So we're hoping to do a lot of work with law students, to work with creating a network of law students across the country, because this is useful for them. It helps them understand how practical realities work, and it sensitizes them, it understands how things work, and it provides this invaluable tool to this litigant to know that there's someone in their corner and helping them navigate this really complicated, difficult system. So one, I would love to have a lot more resources in manpower to help fix this. But another thing that would be amazing is if impact investment, and the thing is, even impact investment into tech for law is hard, because how do you determine impact of awareness? Like, it's a very, very fluid concept. You can't really show that I've created 50 people are aware, have they actually taken action? So it would be wonderful if there was more investment of funds into this to create, to innovate. And the value add is that you'll be creating systemic changes. I mean, maybe it's not profitable in terms of money, but you'll be creating a much more stable society, a much better system of rule of law that will make everything work better. And if we can keep that long, I mean, it's all idealistic, I know, and there are a lot of actual problems, and I sound like I'm sitting in this ivory tower and saying it, but that's the dream, right? Like, what actually happens is very different. But if we can and are able to mobilize resources to work in making this easier, we could make a huge difference. Yeah. And I think Haktashak is going a great step forward in terms of the government schemes. And similarly, the laws and the legal system is as complicated and as confusing and requires that sort of effort.
No, absolutely. And watching this space with great excitement, I think we are at a juncture where we can arrive at a more complicated, more beautiful understanding of what impact actually is. And very many problems in the development sector, broadly speaking, have remained unsolved. And technology has a transformative opportunity, particularly in enabling reach, like Viraj pointed out, to a wide range of the population. But also the intersection of technology with markets means that there are certain limitations that come about, of course, with the inherent limitations that technology itself possesses. So this question of how will we serve where profit pools are not available? How will we make technology available to the last corner is something we need to continue to think about. And hopefully, along with resilience, we continue to unpack these questions. But thank you very much. We're very sorry to have lost Aniket's dropped off. But it was wonderful to have this conversation and hope to continue some of these threads outside as well. Thanks, Yash, and over to you.
Thanks, Ariyo. Thanks, Anisha. Good to meet you.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you. Thank you so much for the speakers for being here and for such a lovely conversation about the different ways in you're using technology towards a bigger goal. And so that brings us to the next session we have lined up for the audience in Lift Karade, which begins at 6 p.m. sharp. Having just heard the founders, we hope to give you a funder's perspective on the active citizenship space in the next session. So stay tuned for that. And thank you, everyone, for being here. Have a nice evening.
Thanks, everybody.